بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين الحمد لله we begin our lesson in عقائد النسفية by praising Allah سبحانه وتعالى for this opportunity for us to continue and we pray that Allah bless all of us inshallah and with forgiveness. And may Allah yani make any this lesson a reason where our sins are forgiven, our prayers are answered. And may Allah yani increase any our hearts with iman and taqwa, and make us any among those any who are close to Him any in dunya and akhirah. And may Allah protect us any from all difficulties, trials, and tribulations. Ameen, ya Rabbal Alameen. In our last lesson in last week, which is our second lesson, we have entered into the Muqaddimah of Al-Imam Taftazani. And as what I mentioned, the one of the best commentaries of Aqaid Nasafiyah is the commentary by Al-Imam Sa'aduddin Taftazani, which we mentioned a bit about his biography in our last lesson, I believe. So we went through the Muqaddimah of Al-Imam Taftazani on the commentary of Aqaid An-Nasafiyah, and he mentioned in his Muqaddimah the reason why he wanted to comment on the Aqaid of Nasafiyah. And then he goes on to speak about some things which is related to the knowledge of Ilmul Kalam, which inshallah ta'ala today we will go through it inshallah. So now inshallah we will enter into our kitab, the one that I posted in the WhatsApp group. So we will see this. This is basically we are at page 16. We're at page 16. So last week basically we spoke about this the Muqaddimah which I mentioned earlier. This is the Muqaddimah. This is the Muqaddimah of Al Imam Taftazani, and this is in page. This is in page 14. Then the translation in page 15. So inshallah ta'ala, this is going to be the first topic of discussion in the commentary of Taftazani. So we have not entered into Aqaid Nasafiyah yet. As I mentioned, there are certain things mentioned by Imam Taftazani which I feel it is important before we enter into the actual text. So let us we will read inshallah what is mentioned by Al-Imam Taftazani. So he mentioned Anwa'ul Ahkam Shar'iyyah, the types of the rulings of Shar'iyyah. Then he mentioned I'lam Anna al-Ahkam Shar'iyyah minha ma yata'allaqu bi kayfiyyatil 'amal wa tusamma far'iyyatan 'amaliyyah wa minha ma yata'allaqu bil i'tiqad وتسمى أصلية اعتقادية والعلم المتعلق بالأولى يسمى علم الشرائع والأحكام لما أنها لا تستفاد إلا من جهة الشرع ولا يسبق الفهم عند إطلاق الأحكام إلا إليها وبثانية علم التوحيد والصفات لما أن ذلك أشهر مباحثه وأشرف مقاصده. So here Al-Imam At-Taftazani mentioned that the rulings of the Sharia. We mentioned last week the meaning of Sharia. When our scholars use the word Sharia, it means rulings that are derived from the sources of revelation. Rulings that are derived from the sources of revelation. And the sources of revelation we have the Al-Quran Al-Karim and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So knowledge that is derived from the Quran or from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we call it ilmu shari. Ilmu shari. So from this knowledge, it is divided into two main categories. Knowledge of the Sharia, it is divided into two parts. This is what Imam Taftazani mentioned, and it is divided into asliya and far'iyah. So we have the roots and we have the branches. We have the roots and we have the branches. So he said I'lam know that the rulings of the Sharia, the number one, minha ma yata'allaku bi kayfiyatil amal. So the first type is rulings that is related to acts of worship or acts any actions any of the mukallaf any basically. So the first time any of knowledge speaks any about the rulings any based any on the action any of the mukallaf. Any mukallaf any meaning yani a person any who is held any responsibility any by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you learn any fiqh any for example, you will know who is any a mukallaf. Our scholars any speaks any about the conditions any of the intellect that he must possess any intellect, aqil, yani he must be baligh, yani a person any who has reached any puberty, wa bulugh da'wa, that the da'wa any of Islam any has reached him. So we say these are the conditions of taklif. So when a person any is any mukallaf, any he is being given any responsibilities, any there are certain actions any which is wajib any upon him any to do, there are certain actions any which is sunnah, there are certain actions which is haram, there are certain actions any that is makruh and mubah. So we have any the five types any of hukum shar'i, taklifi, any this one any we study any in fiqh. So all these things any is related any to actions, any prayers is related any for example fasting, zakah, hajj, it is related any to the actions any of the mukallaf. So this is any the first type al-imam Taftazani any is speaking any about. The first type any is related any to actions and how any to perform any those, how to perform any those actions. What to some fara'iyatan amaliyah. So this category any of knowledge any from the knowledge any of the sharia, which is related any to the actions any of the mukallaf, it is named as fara'iyah. Yani it is considered to be a branch any of the sharia, a branch any of the knowledge any within any Islam, and it is any related to actions, amaliyah. So we have fara'iyah, amaliyah, yani a branch which is related any to, which is related any to actions. Wa minha ma yata'allaku bil i'tiqad. Another time, another category any of the knowledge any of sharia, it is any related any to i'tiqad, yani it is related any to belief and faith. Wa tusamma asliyatan i'tiqadiyah. And this any category is known any as asliyah wa i'tiqadiyah. Yani asliyah, it is any basically any the roots. Whereas earlier any we mentioned any far'iyah, yani it is the branch. Asliyah yani is the opposite, and it is the, it is any the roots. And it is not any amaliyah, but it is i'tiqadiyah. So there is any difference any between amaliyah and i'tiqadiyah. This difference any basically between the knowledge of fiqh and the knowledge of aqidah. Knowledge any of fiqh, any it relates any to the actions any of the mukallaf, whereas any knowledge any of aqidah, any relates any to the belief, yani to the belief any of the mukallaf. So this is the meaning any of i'tiqad, because any meaning any of i'tiqad is basically it is related any to your belief, yani a belief any in something. So the difference any between a type any of belief and a type any of action. Action any is basically any practice, whereas any belief any is something any that is affirmed any by affirm any by the heart. So this is any the difference any between the roots any and the branch. So the roots any refers any to the knowledge any of aqidah, whereas any the branch any refers any to the knowledge any of the knowledge any of fiqh. This is what any he mentioned that he will mention any after this. So this is where Al-Imam Taftazani begins by speaking any about these two types any of knowledge. You have any the roots and you have any the, and you have any the branch. So we can understand that the branch any of this knowledge, it originates any from the roots. The knowledge any of fiqh any comes any from the knowledge any of, the knowledge any of aqidah. So it is built any upon any the knowledge any of, the knowledge any of aqidah. That is why any in fiqh any, for example, if a person who doesn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his ibadah will not be valid. A person any can perform any prayers, a person any can perform any fasting, a person any can perform any zakah, but if he doesn't believe any in the tenets any of Islam, then his ibadah and his actions any will not be valid. So there is any a relation any between the branches any of Islam or the laws any of the Sharia and the roots any of the, and the roots any of the laws any of the Sharia. So it is derived from the roots. So these are any the two main branches. There is another field any of knowledge which is yani important. Usually our scholars any speak any about this knowledge. Just that Imam Taftazani, he didn't mention any the subsequent knowledges which are interrelated any to these two knowledge, and it is a knowledge any of tazkiyah. So the knowledge any of tazkiyah any likewise any it is derived any from the roots and the branch of the knowledge any of the knowledge any of fiqh. So when we speak any about the roots of the sharia any which is any aqidah, and the branch any of the sharia any which is fiqh, and to make perfect any our belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and our actions and in ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sincerity and with all these any good any characteristics, this come any the knowledge any of tasawuf or the knowledge any of tazkiyah. So again any it is derived any from these two main, it is derived any from these two main knowledge. So he said, wa minha ma yata'allaqu. ومنها ما يتعلق بالاعتقاد وتسمى أصلية اعتقادية والعلم المتعلق بالأولى يسمى علم الشرائع والأحكام. So he said any that the knowledge that is related any to the first any refers any to فرعية عملية. It is known as علم الشرائع والأحكام, the knowledge any of the Sharia and rulings, the knowledge any of the Sharia any and yani rulings. Lima annaha la tustafadu illa min jihati syar'i. Because why yani it is called any knowledge any of the sharia? Because all yani the rulings any that is within any this particular knowledge any it is derived any from the syara. Syara yani here any goes any back to the sources any of revelation. It goes back any to the revelation any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards any prophets any and prophets any and messengers. So now any for example any we have the knowledge any of fiqh any for example. The knowledge any of fiqh, it is derived any from the Quran and the Sunnah. So that's why any we say it is the knowledge of Sharia. It is a knowledge of Sharia. It's just that any knowledge any of fiqh, it is related any to the actions any of the mukallaf. And it is considered any to be the branch any because it is knowledge any that is derived any from the roots any of the rules any of the sharia. Later on inshallah you will speak any about usulul fiqh. So now any we have the knowledge any of fiqh which we say that it is derived any from the knowledge and the sharia any because it is derived any from the Quran any from the sunnah, and it is knowledge that is related to the actions any of the mukallaf, and it is considered any to be the branch any of the knowledge any of sharia. So this is how any basically Al-Imam Taftazani yani is telling any to tell us any basically the difference any between knowledge any of fiqh that is related any to the actions of the mukallaf, and the roots any of the sharia which is related any to the knowledge any of aqidah or knowledge of ilmul kalam. Then any he mentioned wala yasbaqul fahmu inda itlaqil ahkami illa ilayha, that you will not any understand any the rulings any except any by the sources any of the sharia. Yani for example any we cannot understand the rulings any within the knowledge any of fiqh. We cannot understand for example that prayers any is wajib, fasting any is wajib, zakah any is wajib, zina any is haram. How do we get any of these rulings pertaining any to our actions, any actions any of the mukallaf? Yani it goes back any to the Quran and the Sunnah. Yani for example Allah mentioned in the Quran wa aqimus salata wa atu zakata, establish any the prayers, establish zakah. So this is any a verse any in the Quran. So we can understand the obligation in your prayers and the obligation in your zakah from yani revelation. So that is why any there is a relation any towards the not sources any of the sharia. This is what any he said. Annaha la tustafadu illa min jihati shari, wa la yasbaqul fahmu inda itlaqil ahkam illa ilayha. That we cannot understand any of the rulings except any by understanding any is derivation any from the sources any of the sharia. Without any the sources any of the sharia, any you will not any get any the rulings any of the branches any of this particular knowledge. And then any he mentioned wabithaniyati ilma tawhid was sifat. So the second any category that is asliya i'tiqadiyya is what any he mentioned. Asliya i'tiqadiyya yani the goods any of the sharia that is related yani to beliefs, that is related any to beliefs, and it is called ilm al-tawheed wa sifat. It is known any as a knowledge any of tawheed or the knowledge any of understanding any of the attributes, any we have attributes any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, attributes any of the prophets. Lima anna dhalika ashharu mabahithihi. Why any it is called any knowledge any of tawheed or knowledge any of sifat? Here Al-Imam Taftazi any mentioned when it comes any to tawheed, one of the main any important any aspects any in learning this knowledge any of aqidah, that is to understand the existence and the oneness any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because any the meaning any of tawheed any is wahada, yani the belief any that Allah yani is one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yani is Allah yani is one. So this is any one of the main important knowledge any that we study any in this particular field. That is any to understand the existence any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to understand any the to understand the oneness any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once any we understand the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, automatically we understand that associatement any to other than Allah yani cannot be accepted. Automatically we will understand that there can be no partner to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But first any we have to establish that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. So here Al-Imam Taftazani and he mentioned, since any the one of the most any important aspects any in learning the knowledge any of aqidah is to understand the oneness any of Allah. That is why this knowledge any is sometimes any called as the knowledge any of tawheed, and sometimes any it is called the knowledge any of sifat. Because again, one of the important aspects any in learning this knowledge is to understand the attributes any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The attributes any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what any he said, lima anna dhalika ashharu mabahithihi. And the reason why it is named such, because any it is the most any important or famous of its contents. Wa ashrafu maqasidihi, and the main any objectives. When we study any this knowledge any of aqidah, knowledge any of tawheed, or knowledge of al-kalam. So basically any in summary any if you look any at what any he is saying, and he basically is speaking about the two categories, any we have any the roots and we have any the branch, and he is saying any the roots and he refers any to i'tiqad, any belief, whereas any the branch and he refers any to the action rulings any that is related to actions. Number one, any rulings any related any to belief. So this is any the knowledge any of tawheed or knowledge any of sifat, and the other one any is the knowledge any of ahkam, or the knowledge any of al-fiqh any, or sometimes any nowadays any people call it the knowledge of sharia. Nowadays any when people say knowledge of sharia, any what they mean any is the knowledge any of fiqh. But originally any the word in sharia any is, as what any we mentioned, anything any that is derived any from the sources of revelation and is called any sharia. So there is a difference any between knowledge of sharia and knowledge of wad'iyya. So when we speak about laws any, for example, nowadays when we say laws any of the country, this is wad'iyya. This is not any based any on the sharia, because it's derivation and it's not any from the sources of revelation. But it is any from the opinions any of certain any individuals. Whereas when we say this is knowledge of sharia, any what we mean any is that it is derived any from sources any of revelation. So this is the difference any between knowledge of sharia and the knowledge any of laws any of the sharia and laws any of wad'iyya. Yani wada'iyya, yani what is implemented any by the society or certain any people. So this is any the overview any basically about the first part where he speaks any about this difference any between the roots any and the roots any and the branch. And you can understand easily if you understand the definition any of the knowledge of fiqh, the definition of the knowledge of knowledge any of aqidah. For example, knowledge of fiqh, the definition any is al-ilmu bil-ahkami shar'iyyati al-amaliyah. Al-ilmu bil-ahkami shar'iyyati al-amaliyah. Yani knowledge that is related yani to the rulings any of the sharia, al-amaliyah. And it is based any on the actions any of the mukallaf. Al-muktasabu min adillatiha tafsiliyah. That is derived any from evidences any that are specific. So the knowledge any of fiqh, it speaks any about rulings that are related any to the actions any of the mukallaf, and it is derived any from evidences any that are specific. Whereas any the knowledge any of aqidah is al-ilmu bil aqaid, yani knowledge that is related any to beliefs. Al-ilmu any bil aqaid. Al-ilmu ala afan. Al-ilmu ala isbatil aqaidi diniya, any knowledge that speaks any about the establishment of the beliefs of this religion any of Islam, min adillatiha al-yaqiniyah. Yani that is derived any from evidences any that are based any on yaqeen. Evidences and that they are based on conviction. Whereas any the knowledge any of fiqh, we speak any about dalil tafsili. That it is derived any from evidences any that are specific. The knowledge any of aqidah speaks any about evidences any that are based any on conviction. Whereas any the knowledge any of usulul fiqh, ma'rifatu dalailil fiqhi ijmalan wa kayfiyatil istifadati minha wa halil mustafid. This is any the definition of the knowledge any of usulul fiqh. So the knowledge any of usulul fiqh, yani it speaks any about dalil ijmali. It is a general or universal type any of evidence. So if you understand any this definition any of the knowledge any of fiqh, the knowledge of ilmu kalam or knowledge of aqidah, and the knowledge of usulul fiqh, any you will find any the difference. So when we speak any about the difference any of these knowledges, we will find, for example, we say that the knowledge any of fiqh is related any to the actions any of the mukallaf. The knowledge any of usulul fiqh, yani speaks any about the evidences any of the knowledge any of fiqh, and evidences that are universal. It teaches us any how the fuqaha derive any rulings, yani from the sources any of revelation, and how yani they use these principles that are general any principles any to derive laws any of the ahkam, yani from the sources of revelation. So this is any basically knowledge of usulul fiqh. When comes any to the knowledge any of aqidah, yani we speak any about al-i'tiqad. So the difference any between knowledge any of aqidah and knowledge of fiqh is that knowledge of aqidah yani speaks any about the belief, whereas knowledge of fiqh speaks by actions. The knowledge of usulul fiqh yani speak any about how the ways any of derivation yani from the evidences any that are general towards any the knowledge any of the knowledge any of fiqh. So these are some of the differences any on some any of these knowledges. So inshallah later on any we will go back into the knowledge of usulul fiqh, and inshallah any we I will explain any further any inshallah. This is just any a summary. So for those any who have been following any my lesson, for example in aqidah sanusiyah, so I hope any that all of you who are really any put in efforts any to understand what is important any is that we have to pay attention any to definition. So by now we should understand what is the definition of ilmul kalam or ilmu aqidah, what is any the definition of ilmul fiqh, the knowledge of fiqh, al ilmu bil ahkam shar'iyyah al amaliyah al muktasabu min adillatiha tafsiliyah, and then also any the knowledge any of usulul fiqh. Ma'rifatu dalailil fiqhi ijmalan wa kayfiyat al istifadati minha wa halil mustafid. And this is any the definition any of the knowledge of usulul fiqh. So three knowledges any we need to at least any have by now: definition any of fiqh, definition any of al kalam, definition any of usulul fiqh. Now these are the things any that Imam Taftazani begin yani in this particular chapter. And then any he mentioned after that, he speaks any about certain any history yani from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how any this knowledge any come about. So he began any by saying وَقَدْ كَانَ الْأَوَائِلُ مِنَ الصَّحَابَةِ وَالتَّابِعِينَ رِضْوَانُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِمْ أَجْمَعِينَ لِصَفَاءِ أَقَائِدِهِمْ بِبَرْكَةِ صَحْبَةِ النَّبِيِّ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ وَقُرْبِ الْعَهْدِ بِزَمَانِهِ وَلِقِلَّةِ الْوَقَائِعِ وَالْإِخْتِلَافَاتِ وَتَمَكُّنِهِمْ مِنَ الْمُرَاجَعَةِ إِلَى الثَّقَافَاتِ مستغنين عن تدوين العلمين وترتيبهما أبوابا وفصولا. So now any the author any speaks any about the early generations amongst any the Sahaba and the Tabi'in. So he mentioned yani those any Sahaba and those any Tabi'in, yani the pious any predecessors. The Sahaba
Yani Sahaba is a plural of Sahabi. And a Sahabi is a person who met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and believe and pass away in Iman. This is basically the definition of a Sahabi. Whereas a Tabi'in, a person who met the Sahaba. So they did not meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they met the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they believe and they pass away in state of Iman. So we say they are the Tabi'in. And then comes the generation after that, we call them as Tabi Tabi'in. So we have the Sahaba, and then we have the Tabi'in, and then we have Tabi Tabi'in, yani the followers of the Tabi'in. So these are basically the three generations where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the famous hadith, Khayrul Quruni Qarni, the best of age is my age, Walladina Yalunahu, Walladina Yalunahu. Aw kama qala sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the best of age is my age, and then the age that comes after it, and the generation that comes after that, and then the generations that come after that. So the first three generations are what we call it as the blessed generations. So now Al-Imam Taftazani, he goes back to the generation of the Sahaba and the Tabi'in. So he mentioned that the speciality of the Sahaba and the Tabi'in, لِصَفَاءِ عَقَائِدِهِمْ يعني because of their preservation and because of the blessing with the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which they live at a time where they are with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and their belief in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and belief in Islam is the belief that is pure, which is not mixed with any ideologies that are present in their society. So during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed the Sahaba and taught them about belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at that particular time, all these different ideologies or different sects within Islam has not been in existence yet. So due to also to their company, the blessing of the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is the first point he said. Number one is because they live at a time where they do not experience different ideologies within Islam. Of course you have beliefs out of Islam, like the Jews and the Christians. Here the author speaks about within the religion of Islam. During the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, during the time of the Sahaba, there is only one version of Islam. That is the Islam that was brought by prophets and messengers. The Islam that was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they are only exposed to what is brought by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they are a bit, he will mention why he mentioned this, because at the end of the day they are not in need to speak about certain ideologies that are against Islam within the Islamic sect. Because in reality, all the Islamic sects which are divine is not in existence at that particular time. So they are not in need of writing certain books in rebuttal and so on, because it is not in existence. Those ideologies have not been in existence. So this is point number one. لِصَفَاءِ عَقَائِدِهِمْ Yani due to their pure belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they do not experience any divine ideologies yet. Yani during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Point number two, say بِبَرَكَةِ صَحْبَةِ النَّبِي sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there is barakah in being in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is why our scholars they differentiate between the Sahaba and the Tabi'in. Even in the knowledge of hadith, our ulama mention as-sahaba kulluhum udul. All of the Sahaba, all of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are just people. They are just. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose them from amongst any nations, and Allah chose the Sahaba to assist the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the propagation of Islam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised them in the Quran. Wal muhajirun wal ansar. وَالَّذِينَ تَبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Then the Sahaba amongst the Muhajirin, amongst the Ansar, and those who follow in their footsteps, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ, Allah is pleased with them, and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah commanded us to follow their footsteps. And this is by the blessing of their company with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But when it comes to the Tabi'in, you will find, for example, the knowledge of Hadith, the Tabi'in, there's jarah wa ta'adil. The scholars have hadith, when it comes to the Tabi'in, and then they will ascertain whether this particular Tabi'in is adil or not adil, whether he is just or not just. But when it comes to the Sahaba, kulluhum udul. All the Sahaba, we do not speak about jarah wa ta'adil. For example, if Abu Hurairah mentioned that a man came, he said a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or he said that Abu Hurairah, for example, he mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and you find many hadith, and he qala Abu an Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is narrated by Abu Hurairah that he said that the Prophet said. He said that the Prophet said. It is accepted, and even though there is a possibility that he might not heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said that the Prophet said. He might heard another Sahabi who heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But since it is Abu Hurairah who is a Sahabi, a scholars of Hadith, they are not really concerned whether it is Abu Hurairah who heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself by his own ears, or he heard from another Sahabi. But if Abu Hurairah mentioned qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, straight away we accept. If Abdullah bin Umar said qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Straight away we accept. And because why? Because kulluhum udul. All of them are considered to be just. When it comes into the Tabi'in, scholars of Hadith, you will find they do jarh wa ta'adil. Whether this particular Sahabi is he adil or not adil, and he can be trusted or not trusted. Did he hear from Sahabi? You find for example, there are certain Hadith munqati, and we call it Hadith Mursal, where the Tabi'in say qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is da'if. If the Tabi'in say qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, meaning what? Meaning there is someone who is not mentioned. Sahabi that is not mentioned. And if this particular Tabi'in is not known, or is not just any person, then automatically it becomes hadith that is da'if. But if this particular Sahabi like Sa'id bin Musayyib, that's what Al-Imam Shafi mentioned, that the marasil of Sa'id ibn Musayyib is accepted, because Sa'id ibn Musayyib is a big alim, and he is son-in-law of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, and it is said that whenever he said qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, most of it he heard from his father-in-law, that is Abu Hurairah. So bi barakati sahbati nabi alaihi salam, it is due to the blessing of the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Point number 2. So if you look here at the matter, number 1, he speaks about lisafa'i aqaidihim, they are with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are not exposed to any ideologies within the Islamic sect, because the Prophet is there. Point number 1. Point number 2, because of the blessing of the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Point number 3, wa qurbil ahdi bi zamanihi, the sahaba and the tabi'in, it is because of their nearness towards the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So all these, differences in views, and all these differences in belief and so on, has not been arise yet. Because it is in the early stage of Islam, during the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, after the death of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, for a few years. وَلِقِلَّةِ الْوَقَعِ وَالْإِخْتِلَافَاتِ, due to the fact that there are not much disagreements between the Muslims at that time, because they are united under the Khalifa. For example, you find after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, during the times of Bakr radiallahu anhu, Muslims were united. During the time of Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab, during the time of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, during the time of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, started some issues, issues with the Khawarij. Issues with the Khawarij, because the some hypocrites and munafiqeen, and some of the Yahud, they wanted any to revenge any, of course, they want to stab any Islam any in the back. So they started any to do any some any fitnah. They started any to cause any some tension any between the factions any of Islam. And the fact that Osman ibn Affan and is from Banu Umayyah, so these hypocrites and this what Khawarij, they start any to instigate and saying any that the Khilafah any should be given any to Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib, should be given any to the Ahlul Bayt and so on and so forth. So now, what you call it, the tension any start any to arise, and at the end any it result in the killing any of Sayyidina Osman ibn Affan any by the Khawarij, and then came any Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib. And what you call it, the tensions and it continue between Sayyidina Ali, the tensions and it has been done and it by this Khawarij and this hypocrites and munafiqeen and Ibn Sabah, Abdullah bin Sabah, and who is a Yahud, who is some of scholars and he mentioned and he's not any Muslim, so he pretended and to be a Muslim and he caused any what you call it a tension and between the Muslim camps any of Muawiyah and Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib any that resulted any in wars and resulted in the killing of Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib any when Sayyidina Ali any has a peace any treaty with Muawiyah. So it led any to the takfir of Sayyidina Ali by the Khawarij, and this led any to the killing any of Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib any by one any of the chief any of the Khawarij any by the name of Abdurrahman al-Muljim. So the tension, the real any tension and during the time any of the Tabi'in and starts any by the killing any of Sayyidina Osman ibn Affan. And Sayyidina Osman ibn Affan was killed and he martyred and he, in the year 35 in Hijriyah, correct? Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib and he, in the year 40 in Hijriyah. So it is about any 24 years any after the death any of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the early any problems any that came any to the Muslim any ummah is the issue any of the Khawarij. The issue any of the Khawarij. Where one of the things any about the Khawarij any is that they always do takfir. They always any do takfir. That even any if a person does an act any which is a major sin, any for example is kafir. So a lot any of the Sahaba any they say are kufar. Because why? Because to them the Sahaba any like Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib, when they come into a priesthood any with Muawiyah, they believe any due to the ignorance any of this Khawarij. They believe any that Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib any has done any a major sin. That Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib any has done any a major sin. And doing any a major sin any to them is an act any of apostasy. And apostasy any can be killed. And this result any in the killing of many of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the battle any of Jamal, in the battle of Safin. And then he mentioned وَتَمَكُّنِهِمْ مِنَ الْمُرَاجَعَةِ إِلَى الثَّقَافَاتِ عفوانا it's وَتَمَكُّنِهِمْ مِنَ الْمُرَاجَعَةِ إِلَى الثِّقَاتِ يعني because any of their ability any to return back any to the scholars to the ulama any they live any at a time anywhere they live in a situation where there are many any ulama. Yani because the companions any of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, any of course any they were great any scholars, the tabi'in, they are any the scholars any of the ummah. Until today, any we return any to their fatwas and we return any to what any day they have what you call it propagated. We are getting any benefit any from those any ulama. So imagine any if you live any during the time any of the Sahaba, you have any people any like. Abdullah bin Abbas radiyallahu anhumah, Abdullah bin Umar radiyallahu anhumah, Abdullah bin Mas'ud. You have any people any like Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib, likewise any Sayyidina Osman, the Khulafa al-Rashidin. Imagine any you live at their time. So certainly any if you have any issues any in certain things, you will ask them. And they easily any can explain any the truth. So when you live any in a society anywhere there is any ulama, any usually what you call it deviancy any will not any occur because every time any a certain any issue any arise automatically any it can be solved. So normally issues any like misunderstanding or deviancy any in understanding any is Islam, understanding any religion, it is the result any of ignorance any of the Muslim any community. So when there is any ignorance, then the doors any towards deviancy any is open wide. So he mentioned وَتَمَكُنِهِمْ مِنَ الْمُرَاجَعَةِ إِلَى الثِّقَاتِ. mustaghnina an tadwinil ilmaini. So due to that, yani they are not any in need any to compile any of these knowledges. So you find that in during the time any of the Sahaba and the time any of the Tabi'in, the knowledge any of fiqh, the knowledge of usulul fiqh has not been compiled yet. Has not been compiled yet. The knowledge any of aqidah also any has not any been compiled. But it is present yani in their hearts, present yani in India yani society. So they are not any in need any of this compilation because any of the presence any of many any ulama and the culture any of memorization any that they have and the culture any of learning any Islam at the highest any level. And this is any we are speaking any about the golden age any of Islam any during any the time any of the Sahaba. And then yani he mentioned watakir mabahithiha furu'an wa usulan. They are not in it any to arrange all these any compilations any into the what you call it, the roots any of a particular knowledge and the branches any that are derived any from the roots. So they are not any in it. Ila an hadasatil fitanu bainal muslimin. Until yani trials any begin any to arise any between the Muslim any communities. When there is any fitnah that arises any amongst any the Muslims, wa ghalaba al-baghyu ala a'immati ad-din, and when people any go against any the leaders any of this deen, go against any the ulama, wa dhahara ikhtilaful ara'i wal mailu ila al-bid'i wal ahwa, and there are differences any that arise and the inclination any towards any innovation and the inclination any to fulfill the evil any desires, wa kathuratil fatawa wal waqi'at, and there are many fatawas any that has been given that are contradictory any to one any another, and due to the fact any that there are many occurrings any that occur during any the time any after any the time any of the early ages of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, wa ruju'i ila al-ulama'i fil muhimmat fashtaghalu bin nadari wal istidlali wal ijtihadi wal istinbat. This is where al-Imam at-Tafdhazani any is getting into. So when there is any fitna, when there is any issues and problems and differences any amongst any people, and people any started any to sway away any from the religion, following any of the desires, not having any sincerity and taqwa, having any bad any intentions any towards any the ulama and the Muslims and so on, as what we mentioned any the khawarij, what you call it, who started any this issue any of takfir, the issue any of killing the leaders any of the Muslims any during any that time. Then he mentioned that the Muslims at that particular time any when they are in this any situation, then they busy any themselves any with ijtihad, they busy and themselves any with this way any of derivation any laws any from the Quran and Sunnah, any they begin any to explain any to the people what is any the truth by bringing in any the evidences any by bringing in what you call it the explanations any in greater any detail by writing any books to rebut any certain any ideologies any that are present that are against the yani religion any of Islam, wa tamhidil qawaid wal usul, and they start any to bring forth any principles any of fiqh, principles any of usul, principles any of aqidah, and likewise any the roots any in explaining what are the roots any of belief any in Islam, what are the roots any of this derivation any of the laws and these principles, wa tartibil abwabi wal fusul, and to put them any in chapters any and sub any chapters, wa taksiril masaili bi adillatiha, and to give any examples any with any the evidences, wa iradi shubah bi ajwibatiha, and to rebut any ashubah any is all these ideologies any that what you call it that have any gray areas any in a sense that it go against any the principles any of Islam and the ulama, they came forth any with rebuttals any basically agudud wa iradi shubahi bi ajwibatiha wa ta'yinil awda'i wal istilahat, and then start any the scholars and start any to bring forth in istilahat terminologies. So last time any for example you don't have any knowledge that is called usulul fiqh, you don't have any knowledge or that is called nahu. For example, during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, any no sahaba any learn any nahu, ja'a zaidun any ja'a fi al-madi zaidun fa'il marfu alamatu rafi'i dhammatun zahira. This is not present in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. it is mentioned any that the first person any who commanded any to compile this knowledge any of Arabic grammar is any Ali bin Abi Talib, because when he started any to listen this lahan, a difference any in the strokes any of what you call it in the Arabic language, because any of many non-Arabs any came into the fall of Islam, and there is a mix Arabs and non-Arabs, so the Arabic any language any become weakened. So Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib any is fearful that the language any of the Arabs any will weaken. So he commanded Abul Aswad Ad-Du'ali any to compile any the laws any of grammar. So he said any to Abul Aswad, "Unhu hadha nahwa." Yani you go by this way. You go any by this way. And he taught any Abul Aswad Ad-Du'ali any where to start and how any that he can establish any of this knowledge. So this knowledge is called knowledge of Nahu, any by the saying any of Sayyidina Ali, to the barakah any of the saying of Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib. Until today it is called any knowledge of Nahu. Actually the meaning of Nahu is like this. Meaning of Nahu, like in Arabic, and you say Nahu Zahabtu ilan Margasa. For example, like we say for example or like. So that is any the meaning of Nahu. The reason why Nahu any is known any to be Arabic any grammar, because any of the saying of Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib, and our scholars any mention to get any this barakah any from the saying any of Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib. Likewise, the knowledge of Usul al-Fiqh, and it is mentioned that Al-Imam Shafi is the first, and imagine, is the first any scholar any to compile the knowledge of Usul al-Fiqh. The first any scholar to compile the knowledge of Usul al-Fiqh, and in his book, any Ar-Risala. And Al-Imam Shafi was born in the year 150 Hijriya. So it is not that during the time of the Sahaba, knowledge of Usul al-Fiqh is not present. It is present, but it is not compiled. That is the difference. Likewise, in the knowledge of Nahu, and in the Arabs, the Quraysh, during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and they understood Arabic any grammar any more than us, but the knowledge is not compiled. The knowledge is not compiled. But they know, Ja'a Zaidun, and it cannot be Ja'a Zaidan, because this is Saliqa. Yani it is natural any in them. The language any is within them. So they are not in need any of writing any books, any of laws of grammar, so that any of your children any can study grammar, because they are not in need any to study any as such, because any of this natural any ability any that they possess, and because of course of the society any is solely any an Arabian any society that is not mixed any with the others yet. Likewise, and knowledge of aqidah any it is present, but it is not any compiled any into books. So when Zaharat al-Fitan, when Al-Imam Mutaftazani and he mentioned when problems and he came and all these ideologies and he came and people and he started to criticize the ulama and all this any deviancy and he occur any in the Muslim any ummah, so the scholars and he felt any the importance any of writing books of establishing any knowledge by differentiating any what is the usul and what is the furu and speak any about laws of derivation any of the rulings any from the sources of revelation. Likewise, what you call it, explaining any what is haq and what is batil, what can be accepted and what cannot be accepted. So all these things, any basically, any they are compiled and they came forth any with istilahat, yani terminologies like the knowledge of usul al-fiqh, the terminology al-umum al-khusus, the terminology any of an-nasikh and wal-mansukh, the terminology any of the knowledge any of fiqh, any for example, the terminology of the knowledge any of usul al-fiqh. The knowledge of aqidah and so on and so forth. So all these terminologies any came forth any when there is a need. وَتَبِيَنِ الْمَذَاهِبِ وَالْإِخْتِلَافَاتِ and explaining any the what you call it this derivation and the difference any in the schools any of thought any in certain any understanding of certain texts, and also the differences any amongst any the ulama any within them. So all this any occur when there is an issue. So what we can benefit any from the saying any of Al-Imam any Taftazani is that whenever any you have issues any in the communities of a certain age, it is important any for the ulama yani to look any for solution. So if any you are living any in an age where there are a lot of false any ideologies or there are a lot of deviancy, so a new strategy and it has to be implemented. A new strategy has to be implemented. And we cannot any be saying during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, any the Sahaba, any they do not any establish any knowledge, meaning they do not compile any knowledge any during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it means any that today we are not any in need. We should just any follow the early any pious any predecessors. That is not the case. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they do not compile knowledge any because any of the reason, as what we mentioned any earlier. This is what Al-Imam Taftazani any mentioned any because any of the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is no ikhtilafat any between any of the Muslims. There is no problems any between any of the Muslims any in understanding deen, and because they are with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they attain any the barakah of the sahbah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, but after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, situation change. After the death any of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, the death of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, and situation change. The coming any of the Khawarij, any the coming any of the Shia, the coming any of the Mu'tazila, the coming of the Mujassima, Mushabbiha, the coming any of atheists, any during that those times, during the time of Imam Abu Hanifa, any he debated any of the atheists any, during any his time. So when there is a change any in the situation, this makes any the ulama felt any that there is a need any to compile any knowledge. Just what Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, when he feels any that the Arabic language any is weakened, he make any the initiative any to compile the Arabic. The Arabic any grammar. So he didn't any say that I should not any be doing any something any that is not been done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he knows that this is any a step any to preserve any knowledge. So we as Muslims, it is important any that we have to understand any this reality, and we have any to understand the time any that we are living. What are the ideologies any that we are exposed to? What are the ideologies any that are endangering the minds any of the Muslims any, for example? Yani if nobody any came forth any with any explanation or any compilation any, for example, and these ideologies any that are damaging any to Islam any are present any rampantly any in the Muslim any community, without anybody taking any effort any to explain in the first place any that ideology any before any rebutting in a what you call it in academic manner. What will happen any is that it will be accepted any by the society, and this is what happened any in history. Whenever any you have any ignorance, whenever any you have what you call it, Muslims any who do not any give any effort any in explanation or educating the Muslim any masses, and this goes back to the ulama, the people any of knowledge. They do not any put in the effort any to look any at the time any that they are living, the challenges any that they are living, the dangers any that they are living, and putting in effort any to curb any certain things. Then what will happen is that when you leave certain any ideologies any unattended, what will happen is that it will be accepted because any the common people and you will be saying that the ulama is keeping quiet, and it shows any that this is something any that is okay, something any that can be accepted. So when we study about our past any scholars, we will find any that the reason any why they compile any knowledge, like people any like Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, any when he wrote Fiqh al-Akbar, Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, any many books any that he wrote, Al-Imam Shafi'i in the fields of Fiqh, in the fields any of Usulul Fiqh, likewise Al-Imam any Malik, Al-Imam al-Bukhari, when comes into the knowledge any of Hadith, Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, when comes into the knowledge of Aqidah and Kalam, likewise Imam Abu Mansur al-Maturidi, any the reason any they wrote any of their books, and they establish any this knowledge because any of their conscience and of their understanding any of the situation any that they are living. Likewise, Al-Imam Ghazali, Al-Imam Haramain, you find any they wrote any books in explaining any some any of the ideologies any that are present any in their time, and all this any were done any as a form any of da'wah, any to inform any the Muslims any about the dangers any of certain things and certain things. So if that is the age any that they are living, and this and what any the ulama, our early any ulama any has done, what more than the age any that we are living today? Today any if we ask any, for example, in terms any of the challenges and in terms any of the ideologies any that are present, and how easily any information is spread any in this in the world any today. Today any if you make any this comparison, we compare any our situation and the situation any of the first 200 years any of Hijrah any, for example, or the first any 300 years any of Hijrah, or you compare this age with the age of Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari or Al-Imam al-Ghazali, if you ask any this question, which is more challenging, the age any of our past any scholars or the age any that we are living, yani a person yani who understand not necessarily any that you are an alim or an ulama. If you read any a lot and you study any the situation, around the world today, you will find yani, that the ideologies yani, that are present, and what you call it, the sects yani, of Islam, the different yani, sects yani, that are contradictory yani, to one another yani, that are present in the world yani, today, is far yani, much greater yani, than any time yani, in the past, far much greater. This shows yani, the importance yani, of us in reviving yani, this knowledge, in understanding yani, this knowledge, and in expanding any this knowledge. This knowledge any has to be expanded. Any knowledge any of Aqidah and Al-Kalam, these are also any as a tools any for us any to explain any Islam and to explain any the difference any between the truth and the falsehood. Then only any we can claim that we Muslims any we have any the answers any to the solutions any that are what you call it that are happening in the world today, because any religion of Islam, as what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum. Today I have perfected in your religion. So religion of Islam any has been perfected any by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And part any of this any perfection any is that its ability to counter any form any of beliefs and any form any of ideology. Any Islam, if it is any learned any properly, in the presence any of the ulama, what will happen is that nothing any is will be left any unexplained. Yani the Quran any speaks about tibyan and li kulli shay, that the Quran yani is a source any of explanation any of everything. So how can we explain any the things any that is happening around us any when we do not pay attention to this particular knowledge? And that is any the knowledge of aqidah, knowledge any of kalam with regards to belief and ideologies. Then and he goes on to say, wa sammau ma yufidu ma'rifat al-ahkam al-amaliyya an adillatiha bil fiqh. Yani as for the first any they name it as fiqh, and as for the second they name it as the ilmul kalam. So inshallah ta'ala, any because of time any, this is going to be the end of our lesson any today, and inshallah yani we will continue next week. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us any with tawfiq any in hidayah. So if there is no question, inshallah, any we will stop here. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna minal khasirin. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhaban nar. Sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen.